Chapter 5, Priorities, and Bona Fide Purchasers. Section 73, Priorities, and Equities Relating Thereto. When the owner of a legal estate conveys in good faith all of his interest in it to another, it is manifest that he cannot, by a second conveyance of the same estate to a third person, vest any title thereto in such third person. No one can transfer to another a greater right than he himself possesses, and, at the time of his second conveyance, the conveyor had no right or interest to convey. Hence, as between two vendees of the same property, the first in order of time prevails, except in so far as the effect of this rule is changed by the registration laws and the doctrine of notice. A similar rule of priorities prevails in reference to the acquisition of equitable interests, the rule being expressed in the maxim, "Where there are equal equities, the first in order of time shall prevail." This doctrine of priorities in equity is based on good reason and good conscience. It is manifestly both reasonable and right that he, who first acquires an interest in any property, should be protected in his acquisition. Otherwise the law of force must prevail, and instead of priority of time giving superiority of right, the maxim would read superiority of might gives superiority of right, and he would hold the property who could bring to bear the greatest force, or the shrewdest strategy. The equitable doctrine of priority in time giving superiority in right applies only as between persons having equitable interests, and only then when those equitable interests are in all other respects equal, for priority in time does not give a superiority in right if the prior equity is, in other respects than in point of time, a superior equity. 1. The fundamental rules of priority. The equitable doctrine concerning priorities is embodied in the three following general rules. First, among successive equitable estates, or interests, where there exists no special claim, advantage, or superiority in any one over the others, the order of time controls. Under these circumstances, the maxim, among equal equities, the first in order of time prevails, furnishes the rule of decision. 2d. Between a legal and an equitable title to the same subject matter, the legal title in general prevails. In pursuance of the maxim, apostrophe, where there is equal equity the law must prevail. D. The legal title being outstanding and not involved in the controversy, where there are successive unequal equities in the same subject matter, as where there is a complete or perfect equitable estate in the one party and an incomplete or imperfect equitable estate or a mere equity in the other party, or where among equitable interests of a like intrinsic nature, one is affected by some incident or quality which renders it inferior to another, then the precedence resulting from order of time is defeated, and the superior equitable estate or interest prevails over the others, as is manifestly implied in the maxim, "Where there are equal equities, the first in order of time must prevail." 2. Priorities of attachments, judgments, and executions. Priority, in order of time, prevails to the same extent when liens are acquired by the filing of attachment bills, or the levy of attachment writs. In all such cases, where the right of the complainant attached either directly by the filing of an attachment bill, or indirectly by the levy of the attachment writ for his benefit, that right operates as a lispendens, and, if perfected by a sale, the title of the purchaser will relate back to the filing of the bill, or to the levy of the writ, as the case may be, and, if there be several bills or several levies, their priorities will be in the order of time, beginning with the oldest lien, if the equities of the parties are otherwise equal. If two or more levies by attachment are made at the same time, they will be treated as one levy, and a pro rata distribution of the proceeds will be made. The priorities of judgments and decrees, and of the liens thereby created, are determined by their respective dates, or registration. The priorities of different levies by execution on the same tract of land are regulated by the order of time in which the levies are made, and the priorities of different levies by execution on the same personalty are determined by the priorities of the dates of their respective testes. And in conflicts between attachment liens, judgment liens, and execution liens, the first in order of time will prevail. 3. Equities and liabilities of purchasers. In applying these rules, it becomes important to know when one equity is superior to another. Courts of equity recognize no inequality based on form, or mode of creation, provided the equitable interest is perfected and is based upon a valuable consideration. The following rules will aid in determining this question. 1. The equitable interest created by a trust, or by a contract in rem, made upon a valuable consideration, is superior to the equity arising from a mere voluntary transfer, or from the satisfaction of a pre-existing debt. 2. The equity acquired by a party who has been misled, is superior to the interest in the same subject matter of the one who willfully procured or suffered him to be misled. An equity, otherwise equal or even superior, may, through the gross lackeys, or the intentional deceit of the holder, be postponed to the equity of another acquired as a result of such lackeys or deceit. Any conduct which equity regards as constituting fraud, either an actual intention to mislead, or that gross negligence which produces all the effects, and merits all the blame, of intentional deception, will operate to postpone the equity of the person guilty thereof as against the equity of the person thereby misled. 3. A party taking an estate or interest with notice of another's equity therein, takes subject to that equity, that is, the purchaser of an estate or interest, legal or equitable, even for a valuable consideration, with notice of any existing equitable estate, interest, claim or right, in or to the same subject matter, held by a third person, is liable in equity to the same extent, and in the same manner, as the person from whom he made the purchase. A purchaser with notice of a trust, either express or implied, becomes himself a trustee for the beneficiary as to the property purchased, and is bound in the same manner as the original trustee from whom he purchased. A purchaser or mortgagee with notice of the express equitable lien of a vendor for unpaid purchase price, takes the land subject to that lien. A purchaser or mortgagee of the legal estate, with notice of an equitable lien by a prior defective mortgage, or by any other means from which an express equitable lien can arise, is bound by the lien. A purchaser with notice of a prior contract to sell or to lease, takes subject to such contract, and is bound in the same manner as his vendor to carry it into execution. 4. Exceptions to the rules of priority. While, as between successive purchasers or assignees of an assignable interest, the general rule is that he is entitled to the preference who first gives notice of the assignment to the debtor, the following are the exceptions to the rule. 1. All negotiable instruments, whether negotiable by the law merchant or by statute, may be transferred either by written endorsement, by delivery, or otherwise, without any notice to the maker. 2. Certificates of stock in a corporation may be assigned without notice to the corporation. 3. Life insurance policies may be assigned without notice to the company, in the absence of any contract to the contrary. Section 74. Assignments. How affected by priorities. What has been said in reference to the manifest equities arising out of several conveyances of the same property by the same vendor to several vendees, applies with equal force to successive assignments of an unnegotiable chosen action by the same as senior to different assignees. But, as there are facts in the latter case different from those in the former case, some important modifications of the rules of priority in sales of realty become necessary. Where there are successive equitable assignments of a fund to different parties, it would seem, on first thought, that, as the legal estate is outstanding, and as the interests of all the successive assignees are similar in their essential nature, the first in order of time should prevail, under the maxim qui prioris temporis potioris juri. On fuller deliberation, however, important considerations will appear sufficient to take such assignments out of the operation of the general rule. Where an equitable interest in land is created, the holder thereof can protect himself by having it registered. Where an equitable interest in chattels is obtained, it can be secured by a transfer of the possession, or by reducing the agreement to writing and having it registered. But no such safeguards exist in case of assignments of a chosen action. The legal title, which is analogous to the possession, remains vested in the debtor, trustee or holder of the fund, while the creditor or beneficiary, even after one or more assignments of all his interest, continues clothed with full apparent right to make further assignments. 1. Notice to debtor when necessary to perfect an assignment. It is, therefore, settled law that, while, as against the assignor himself, no notice of the assignment of a non-negotiable chosen action, or fund, need be given to the debtor, trustee or other holder of the fund, nevertheless, that, as against subsequent assignees for a valuable consideration, notice to the debtor, trustee, or holder of the fund is necessary in order to perfect the assignment and render it valid and effectual, and that, among successive assignees of the same thing in action who have paid a valuable consideration, the assignee in good faith and for value who first gives notice, obtains a precedence over the others, even though they may be earlier in time, the equities of the successive assignments being otherwise equal, the priority among them is determined by the order of the dates of the notices, rather than by the order of the dates of the assignments. Giving notice is regarded as equivalent, or as least analogous to, the act of taking possession, and until notice is received by the debtor, payment by him to the assignor would be valid, and bind the assignee. It should be carefully observed, however, that to enable a subsequent assignee to obtain a priority in this manner, by giving the first notice to the debtor or legal holder, he must be an assignee in good faith, and for a valuable consideration. If he has parted with no consideration, he is a mere volunteer, and stands in the same position as his assignor. If he had notice of the earlier assignment, then he took subject thereto. Two cases where notice is not required. The foregoing rules in reference to the need of notice in case of assignments of choses in action, do not apply in the following cases. 1. All negotiable instruments, whether negotiable by the law merchant, or made so by statute, may be transferred without any notice to the makers. 2. Certificates of stock in a corporation may be assigned without notice to the corporation. 3. Life insurance policies may be assigned without notice to the company, in the absence of any contract to the contrary. 3. To whom notice must be given. Notice may be given to the debtor, trustee, or holder of the fund, either in writing, or verbally, if the latter form is explicit, definite and certain. Notice to one of two or more co-trustees, or joint debtors is, in general, notice to all, but it ceases to be operative when such trustee, or debtor, dies, or such trustee gives up his position. No notice to the assignor is necessary to make him liable when the debtor refuses to pay the debt assigned, except in case of negotiable paper, to which the rules concerning notice do not apply. These rules, requiring notice to the debtor or holder of the fund, are confined to transfers of personal property, debts, money claims arising from contracts, accounts and the like, but not to equitable interests in land, or to negotiable paper. The assignee must not only notify the debtor, but he must do so promptly, and obtain possession of the chosen action if in writing, and if not take such steps as are equivalent to actual possession. A prior assignee may lose his priority by any lacunae which injures a subsequent bona me assignee. 4. Equities of the debtor against the assignee. The assignee of a thing in action not negotiable, takes the interest assigned subject to all the defenses, legal and equitable, of the debtor who issued the obligation, or of the trustee or other party upon whom the obligation originally rested. That is, when the original debtor, or trustee, in whatever form his promise or obligation is made, if it is not negotiable, is sued by the assignee, the defenses, legal and equitable, which he had at the time of the assignment, or at the time when notice of it was given, against the original creditor, avail to him against the substituted creditor. This rule applies to all forms of contract not negotiable, and to all defenses which would have been valid between the debtor party and the original creditor. These defenses may 1. Arise out of, or be inherent in, the very terms or nature of the obligation itself, as that it was conditional, and the condition has not been performed by the assignor, or the failure or illegality of the consideration, and the like, or 2. They may exist outside of the contract, as seat off, payment, release, the condition of accounts between the original parties, and the like. It is essential, however, that the equity in favor of the debtor should exist at the time of the assignment, or before notice thereof, for, after receiving notice, he cannot, by a payment, release, obtaining a seat off, or any other act, defeat or prejudice the right of the assignee. The debtor, who would have been entitled to equities under this rule, may, by actual misrepresentations, or by conduct, or even by silence, towards the assignee, estop himself from setting them up, and he may release them. Section 75. Bona fide purchasers and their equities, comma, where a person owns a valid subsisting interest in property, his right thereto should be superior to another's who subsequently acquires possession of the same property. 1. Without acquiring the legal title thereto, or 2. Without paying any valuable consideration therefor, or 3. With notice of the prior adverse interest, or 4. Without good faith. On the other hand, where a person's interests, though valid, are not so evidenced as to give notice thereof, his right thereto should be inferior to another's who acquires possession of the same property. 1. With a conveyance of the legal title. 2. Paying therefor a valuable consideration. 3. Without any notice of the prior adverse interest, and 4. In good faith. This defense of innocent purchaser is founded on the maxim, where the equities are equal, the law will prevail, and the defendant having both the possession and the legal title, while the complainant has only an equitable title, it is manifestly just to prefer the defendant, his equities being fully equal to complainant's, and he having in addition both the possession and the legal title. Where the equities are equal, superior is the condition of the defendant. Besides, the complainant was guilty of negligence in not having his interests so evidenced as to give purchasers notice of his rights, and his case consequently falls under the ban of the maxim, when a loss must fall on one of two persons, it should be borne by him whose act or negligence caused it. Were the law otherwise, no man would ever be safe in making a purchase. In order, then, that the defense of bona fide purchaser may be effectual, all of the following essentials must appear. 1. There must have been a purchase. 2. There must have been a valuable consideration paid. 3. The conveyance must have been taken and the consideration paid before notice of the prior adverse equity, and 4. The whole transaction must have been characterized by good faith. These essentials will be considered separately. 1. There must have been a purchase. The very cornerstone of this defense is the fact of a purchase. The purchase must have been fully consummated before notice, so fully consummated that nothing was left to be done in order to effectuate it. If the purchase had not been completed before notice, the defendant had the right to abandon the proposed purchase, or to obtain indemnity against the alleged equity, and if he did neither, it was his own negligence or willfulness, and he has no right to complain of any loss caused by the alleged equity, of which he had notice. The fact that the consideration was valuable, and that it was actually paid, will not avail if the purchaser had notice before the deed was delivered, or the purchase otherwise absolutely consummated. 2. There must have been a valuable consideration paid. A valuable consideration means, and necessarily requires, under every form and kind of purchase, something of actual value, capable, in the estimation of the law, of pecuniary measurement, such as parting with money or money's worth, or an actual change of the purchaser's legal position for the worse. The amount of the purchase price, if otherwise there is good faith, is not generally material. As examples of what clearly amount to a valuable consideration are the following. 1. A contemporaneous advance or loan of money. 2. Or a sale, transfer, or exchange of property, made at the time of the purchase, or execution of the instrument. 3. Or the surrender or relinquishment of an existing legal right, or the assumption of a new legal obligation which is in its nature irrevocable. An antecedent debt is not deemed a valuable consideration, because the purchaser parts with nothing, and will lose nothing if the sale to him is set aside. He can be put in statu quo. Not only must there be a valuable consideration in fact, but it must be paid before notice of the prior claim. Notice after the agreement for the purchase is made, but before any payment, will destroy the character of bona fide purchaser. Where a part only of the price or consideration has been paid before notice, either the defendant should be entitled to the position and protection of a bona fide purchaser pro tanto, or the complainant should be permitted to enforce his claim to the whole land only upon condition of his doing equity, by refunding to the defendant the amount already paid before receiving the notice. The payment must have been actually made, or what, in law, is tantamount to actual payment, must have been done before any notice. Payment may consist of 1. A transfer of money, property, or things in action, or 2. an absolute change of the purchaser's legal position for the worse, or 3. The assumption by him of some new irrevocable legal obligation. It follows, therefore, that his own promise, contract, bond, covenant, bond and mortgage, or other non-negotiable security for the price, will not render the party a bona fide purchaser, nor entitle him to protection, for upon failure of the consideration he can be relieved from such obligations in equity, even if not at law. Payment of actual cash is not indispensable. The absolute transfer of notes, bonds, or other securities made by a third person, will, however, constitute a good consideration. 3. There must have been no notice of prior equities. The purchaser must have completed his purchase and paid the consideration without any kind of notice, actual or constructive, of prior adverse rights in or to the subject matter of his purchase. The rules of notice, and their underlying principles, have already been fully considered elsewhere, and need not be repeated, and only the time and effect of notice will be stated in this section. The rule is universal that if a purchaser received notice of prior adverse rights in and to the subject matter of his purchase, before he has completely perfected his purchase, or paid the purchase price, he is not a bona fide purchaser. If, however, a second purchaser for value and without notice purchases from a first purchaser who is charged with notice, he thereby becomes a bona fide purchaser, and is entitled to protection as such. Or, if a second purchaser with notice acquires title from a first purchaser who was without notice, and bona fide, he succeeds to all the rights of his immediate grantor. But if a person holding a title affected with notice, conveys to a bona fide purchaser and afterwards takes a reconveyance to himself, he will hold the land subject to all the equities against it at the time he conveyed it. 4. There must have been good faith in the whole transaction. As this defense is based largely on the alleged good faith of the purchaser, and as he specially avers this good faith in his plea, it necessarily results that if any act of bad faith appear, the defense of innocent purchaser will not avail. This bad faith may consist in 1. A completion of the purchase after notice. 2. Fraudulent conduct towards the vendor in the transaction. 3. Participation in an intended fraud on the creditors of the vendor. 4. Or any other matter showing that in the purchase the purchaser has not kept his hands absolutely clean. Section 76. Equities of purchasers. How affected by notice of prior claims. The law of notice and its effects has been heretofore considered somewhat generally, but a further consideration with special reference to the effect of notice upon purchasers is appropriate here. Notice is either actual or constructive. 1. Actual notice is positive personal information of a fact directly communicated to the party, or directly acquired by him. 2. Constructive notice is the sort the law presumes the party to have acquired. 1. What constructive notice includes? Constructive notice includes all kinds of notice not shown to have been actually given. It assumes that no information concerning the prior fact, claim, or right, has been directly and personally communicated to the party, or at least, that the communication of such information is not shown by evidence, but is only inferred by operation of legal presumption. It embraces all those instances, widely differing in their external features, in which either from certain extraneous facts, or from certain acts or omissions of the party himself, disclosed by the evidence, the information is conclusively presumed to have been given to or received by him, or is inferred by a prima facie presumption of the law in the absence of contrary proof. 2. What is meant by being put upon inquiry? A purchaser, or person obtaining any right in specific property, is not affected by vague rumors, hearsay statements, and the like, concerning prior and conflicting claims upon the same property, because he thereby acquires no positive information, and obtains no tangible clue, by means whereof he may commence and successfully prosecute an inquiry into the truth. On the other hand, if the party obtained knowledge or information of facts which tend to show the existence of a prior right in conflict with the interest which he is seeking to obtain, and which are sufficient to put a reasonably prudent man upon inquiry, then it may be a legitimate, and perhaps even necessary, inference that he acquired the further information which constitutes actual notice. This inference may be defeated by proper evidence. If the party shows that he made the inquiry, and prosecuted it with reasonable diligence, but still failed to discover the conflicting claim, he thereby overcomes and destroys the inference. If, however, it appears that the party obtained knowledge or information of facts, which were sufficient to put a prudent man upon inquiry, and which were of such a nature that the inquiry, if prosecuted with reasonable diligence, would certainly have led to a discovery of the conflicting claim, then the inference that he acquired the information constituting actual notice is necessary and absolute, for this is only another mode of stating that the party was put upon inquiry, that he made the inquiry and arrived at the truth. Finally, if it appears that the party has knowledge or information of facts sufficient to put a prudent man upon inquiry, and that he wholly neglects to make any inquiry, or having begun it, fails to prosecute it in a reasonable manner, then, also, the inference of actual notice is necessary and absolute. 3. What facts will put one on inquiry? A purchaser may be put on inquiry by visible objects, structures, or easements upon, or connected with, the land with which he is dealing. So, a purchaser or encumbrancer of an estate, who knows, or is properly informed, that it is in the possession of a person other than the vendor or mortgager with whom he is dealing, is thereby charged with the constructive notice of all the interest, rights and equities which such possessor may have in the land. But, in order that possession may put a purchaser on inquiry and operator's notice, it must exist at the time of the transaction by which his rights and interests are created. Possession by a lessee is constructive notice to a purchaser, not only of the tenant's rights and interests directly growing out of, or connected with, the lease itself, but also of all rights and interests which he may have acquired by other and collateral agreements, as, for example, a contract to convey the land, or to renew the lease, and the like. 4. Notice by recitals in deeds. Whenever a purchaser holds under a conveyance, and is obliged to make out his title through that deed, or through a series of prior deeds, the general rule is firmly established that he has constructive notice of every matter connected with or affecting the estate, which appears, either by description of parties, by recital, by reference, or otherwise, on the face of any deed which forms an essential link in the chain of instruments through which he must derive his title. Any description of the parties, as married women, trustees, executors, administrators or the like, any recital of fact, or reference to other documents, puts the purchaser upon inquiry, and he is bound to follow up this inquiry step by step, from one discovery to another, from one instrument to another, until the whole series of title deeds is exhausted, and a complete knowledge of all the matters referred to in their provisions and affecting the estate, is obtained. 5. Effect of notice of a deed, or other instrument. If a purchaser or encumbrancer, dealing concerning property of which the record title appears to be complete and perfect, has information of extraneous facts or matters in pais, sufficient to put him on inquiry respecting some unrecorded conveyance, mortgage, or encumbrance, or respecting some outstanding interest, claim, or right which is not the subject of record, and he omits to make a proper inquiry, he will be charged with constructive notice of all the facts which he might have learned by means of a due and reasonable inquiry. Where a purchaser has notice of a title deed, he is presumed to know all its contents and is bound thereby, and if any conveyance, of which he has notice, should contain a recital of, or reference to, another deed otherwise collateral and not a part of the direct series, he would by means of such recital or reference, have notice of this collateral instrument, of all its contents and of all the facts indicated by it which might be ascertained through an inquiry prosecuted with reasonable diligence. This rule applies to both registered and unregistered instruments. 6. Notice by registration. Our statutes authorize the registration of certain instruments relating to the sale, encumbrance, lease and devise of real and personal property, and they make such instruments when duly probated and noted for registration, notice to all the world of their existence and contents. The statutes give priority to these instruments in the order of their notation. 8. For registration, and they declare that any registrable instrument not properly probated or registered or noted for registration, shall be null and void as to existing or subsequent creditors of, or bona fide purchasers from, the makers without notice. The objects of our registration laws are: 1. to preserve the muniments of title, 2, to perpetuate the evidence of their valid execution, 3, to give the community notice of the changes in the ownership of property, and, 4, to prevent frauds both upon the bargainer and upon his creditors. In order, therefore, that a registered instrument may be noticed to the world, it must be, 1, an instrument authorized to be registered, 2, it must be properly proven, or acknowledged and certified, 3, it must be registered, or noted, for registration, and, 4, this registration must be in the proper county. The record operates as a constructive notice only when the instrument itself is one which the statute authorized to be registered. The voluntary recording, therefore, of an instrument, when not authorized by the statute, would be a minullity, and would not charge subsequent purchasers with any notice of its contents, or of any rights arising under it. For the same reason, the operation of a record as constructive notice is limited territorially. A record is not a notice with respect to any tract of land situated in a different county from that in which the registration is made. The statute requires the instrument to be registered in the same county in which the land, or a part of the land, is situated. A record in a different county is, therefore, inoperative as a constructive notice. A record is a constructive notice only when, and so far as, it is a true copy, substantially, of the instrument which purports to be registered, and of all its provisions. Any material omission or alteration will certainly prevent the record from being a constructive notice of the part omitted or altered, although the instrument may appear, on the registry books, to be perfect and operative in all its parts. Nor will the record be a notice unless it, and the original instrument of which it is a copy, correctly and sufficiently describe the premises which are to be affected. When all the foregoing requisites to a valid registration have been complied with, when an instrument is, 1, entitled to be registered and, 2, has been duly executed and acknowledged or approved and certified, and, 3, has been registered or noted for registration in the proper manner, and, 4, in the proper county, then such record becomes a constructive notice, not only of the fact that the instrument exists, but of its contents, and of all the estates, rights, titles and interests, legal and equitable, created or conferred by it, or arising from its provisions.